Your Voice, a program for you to see how Senator Mark Grisanti is representing Western New York. I'm Julia Locandy. How are you, Senator?
Doing great, Julie. How are you doing?
I'm doing good.
Excellent, excellent.
Thanks for being here.
You know, it's a few days left in session, so there's a lot going on.
Yeah, you're trying to enact new legislation regarding Buffalo's school system. And really, the bottom line is to, you know, make better use of tax dollars and to make sure that kids are graduating high
right.
school and, you know, have a chance to be successful at life. So explain that for us.
Well, you know, there's two components. The first, I mean, the Buffalo Public School System controls, you know, over $800 million that just approved by the board. So, I mean, we basically have to have accountability, some transparency as to where that money's going to make sure it's directed in the right location. And if it's not, then, you know, we got to leave it up to the taxpayers. So, and the other one has to deal with changing the date of the school board elections from May to November because of very, very poor turnout in that area.
Right. Explain how a school budget is enacted in Buffalo, because it's kind of different than other places in New York.
You know, it is. Basically, I don't think the taxpayers of the city of Buffalo actually know how it's enacted. Basically, they get money from the state. They also get money from the city of Buffalo. Mm-hmm. It's taxpayer money throughout the state and taxpayer money from the city of Buffalo residents themselves. And basically, you don't hear anything about it. It just kind of goes through the board. They approve it. There's always increases, even though we are, you know, trying to do some relief and mandates and things along those lines. And no one actually knows, other than the board and maybe, you know, some of their staff, exactly what is in the budget and where that money goes.
Right. So you mentioned moving the school board election date.
Right.
How will that help?
Well, right now they have a very poor turnout. I mean, in 2010, they only had 4% of eligible voters actually come and vote. So without parental involvement, without people actually being involved in the school board election itself, you know, you have, you know, various factions that want a specific individual in there, and they'll spend money on pushing for that particular individual when it's probably not really the person that the taxpayers would really want had they done their homework and moving forward to actually take time to vote in the school board election. So. By changing it to November, when you have basically all the other major elections going on, it opens up the field of candidates, and it also opens up so people can actually participate, and they should, as taxpayers of the city of Buffalo, participate in the vote for your school board members, whether you have kids or not, because it may help change the genetic makeup, really, of the board itself to then go ahead and be more accountable for the parents and the residents of the city of Buffalo.
Right, you explained that. Your legislation would require Buffalo Board of Education to, you know, submit the school district budget to the voters to approve before it's adopted, which
right.
seems logical.
Right.
So you give plenty of reasons to make this case. Let's take a look at those.
My fellow colleagues, the Buffalo School District, as we know, is a dependent school district, dependent on the state of New York for its money. And as such, I feel that our residents of the city of Buffalo should get a chance to vote on how the school district and the school budget is allocated, and they don't have that opportunity. Unlike most school districts, they can vote on their budget. And the district parenting council that's in Buffalo contends that through the research, the district's voting on their school budget, they have higher graduation rates with fewer persistently low-achieving schools and fewer schools under review. This legislation seeks to make the district more accountable to a community that has a budget of over $800 million. That's a city of Buffalo school district budget, $800 million, and the people of Buffalo don't get to vote on it. So with graduation rates in the Buffalo school system at 50%, at 31% for African Americans and for Hispanics, 31%, spending over $27,000 per student, it's a disgrace. So it's vital that we allow our parents to be involved in these type of decisions to move forward with bioinformatics and science technology. These kids are not ever getting the opportunity to go to a secondary school and further their education, where we have in Buffalo Say Yes to Education that allow them to have free college tuition through a program that's been set up, but they're not gonna get there because they're not graduating from high school. So the struggles of our school district is something that's not gonna be solved overnight, but I believe this, and along with other bills that have been passed, like moving the elections of the school districts from May to November, can help out tremendously. We need greater accountability from our elected members of the Buffalo Board of Education and also their appointed employees, and I urge you to vote for this bill. It's important for the students in the city of Buffalo.
All right. Well, you just said a lot there, so let's break that down. First, 50% graduation rate, $27,000 per student, and a program to go to college for free, yet, you know, only half of the students are even eligible to go there.
Right, and that's not even including the African-American students and also the Hispanic students, where the graduation rate is a lot lower. So, you know, they set up a Say Yes to Education program where if you graduate high school, you actually have a free four-year college tuition.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, these kids are not going to be able to take advantage of that because they're not graduated. And what I'm hearing for this year, the rates are going to be even worse. So the state education department is going to have those rates coming out within the next couple of days, and I'm hearing it's not a pretty picture. I mean, we have numerous schools. When I first started in the Senate in 2011, we only had like 11 schools that were on the persistently low achieving. That's a federal a standard, basically, and a state follows it. We're almost triple that right now, and that's in basically 2.5 years. So something's not right, something's got to give. This is not a end-all, be-all, but I think by having accountability, you know, where's the money going? I mean, are you putting it in the right programs, you know, for these kids to learn? They're cutting music, they're cutting art, they're cutting gym. I mean, these, you know, we have obesity rates and they're actually cutting gym, mm-hmm. I mean, in some of these programs, so it's not wise. I remember last year, they cut summer school and basically sent the materials home with the kids and said, here, you do it. I mean, who does that? I mean, you know, how can you possibly, here's your stuff. Let's see if you can get it on your own, and then we'll give you a test at the end of the summer. I mean, that's, I don't know who comes up with these ideas, but thank God that that's been put back into place. But it's things like that that are not helping out our kids at all.
Yeah, certainly dwelling in the 11th hour concept, and it's well after noon.
Right, absolutely.
You actually believe in a voucher system.
I do.
So explain that for us.
Well, again, you have $25,000 to $27,000 spent on a child per year. I mean, we have legislation that implements a voucher program, kind of like a pilot program. You know, we're talking about 300 or 400 kids, where the parents actually get to choose where they want their child to go to school, whether it's a Catholic school, whether it's a private school, whether it's a public school. You know, so it gives them the opportunity. You know, if there's going to be money spent, well, let me see where I want my child to go. And that's what the voucher program is set up to do. It worked well in Milwaukee. They had rates of graduation similar to ours, and they implemented a voucher system in the city of Milwaukee. And basically, the graduation rates, I think within a short period of time, jumped from like the high 40s, low 50s, up until the high 70s, low 80s. So it does work.
Right, and you have all of those exciting developments at UB, and
right. You
know, it's a shame that so many of the high school kids from Western New York couldn't take advantage of that, and they could get a free ride.
Absolutely,
doing that.
Yeah, and they had recently they had an article in the Buffalo News that talked about the jobs and the positions that are going to be available, but yet we don't have the kids that are graduating with that type of knowledge and skill to be able to apply for those jobs. So, I mean, the jobs are going to be there, and these are well-paying jobs that can easily provide for a family. And without these kids graduating, you're going to see them basically on the, on you know, in social services and programs like that. We don't want that to happen. We want them to go ahead and get jobs and be productive.
Right. Talk about some of those jobs that are available, because they're doing some really exciting things.
Yeah, you know, in bioinformatics, you know, basically when you're talking about you know, not only the design and makeup and building, it's basically all engineering, it's all math, it's all science, and that's not being focused on in our school system. You also have colleges, though, that are now focusing on radiology, occupational therapy, physical therapy. These are all things that are in the Buffalo Niagara Medical Corridor and some of the hospitals beyond, but these are very important because that, to me, as I said before, that area is like the new Bethlehem Steel. These are very, very high-paying jobs that people need to take advantage of. So, and the only way to do it is basically get out of high school, go to college, focus on that field, and you'll see. I mean, the jobs will be here, and then people will stay.
So, greater accountability for the elected members, and you know, as well as the employees who are appointed.
Right.
Do you think that's going to make a difference?
I think it's a step in the right direction. I mean, I think that the struggles of our school district is not something, as I said, that's going to be changed overnight. But I think you know, when you do things over and over again, it's a definition of insanity. So that's what's happening here. I mean, for 20 years, it's been the same way over and over and over again. And, you know, we need to change that mind frame. And, you know, let's see if the dollars are actually going where they are. I mean, there are times, I don't know about this past super or this superintendent now, but the past superintendent would basically hire individuals and that the residents and the taxpayers of the state of Buffalo did not even know that his staff, you know, actually went up by 10 people. Very high paying jobs in the superintendent's office, but yet the residents don't have any knowledge of that happening until actually he left. And that's not something we need to tolerate. I mean, the money needs to be spent on the kids.
Right. You know? Yeah. So there is more information on your website, Grisanti.NYsenate.gov.
Absolutely. Yep.
The next issue, the Peace Bridge Authority, you know, whether you live in the area or not, there's a lot of heated news coverage. You explained this issue and New York's proposed legislation to your colleagues. Let's listen.
Thanks.
At the present time, we have deadlock at the PBA, which is the public bridge authority that connects Canada and Western New York. Believe it or not, it's a 10-member board. You have 5 Canadians and 5 Americans. This is not about American versus Canadian citizens. This is about a board. 5 Canadians, 5 Americans. It's an authority. While there is deadlock, nothing is being done. That has been the problem for over 2 decades, 20 years with regards to this bridge authority. The issue that is deadlocked now, I hope, gets resolved. The PBA has done some environmental reviews, approved what I call cosmetic type makeup projects to the plaza on the US side at the cost of under about $50 million, when on the Canadian side it was about $120 million. The problem is that the plaza needs to be done on how Western New York and how New York State sees fit. When the PBA agreed on the Canadian plaza, we didn't dictate how their plaza should be built, and it's a beautiful plaza. The general manager of the board, who was part of the Canadian Five, stated in his own words that congestion entering the U.S. remains a problem given more stringent custom procedures in an ill-functioning plaza. But yet at the same breath, he states that by virtue of the PBA's much greater land holdings in Canada, there is less pressure to expand the U.S. plaza in Buffalo. Now, it's simple, ladies and gentlemen. Western New York, the governor, we want to do a bigger and better plaza to move truck and vehicular access off the bridge, to improve the air quality, to restore the Olmsted Park that used to be in existence there, to have a wonderful gateway into New York, in Western New York area from Canada, and to move trade and commerce back and forth across the bridge rather than these trucks sitting on the bridge, causing asthma and other problems in the region. Also, New York has the ability to do design and build legislation where the PBA does not. And what that'll do is move the projects faster. And also, as I understand it, the way I believe it, is that projects also can be done at the same time. That includes the pre-inspection of trucks on the Canadian side, which is set to start and have a pilot project in 2015. The U.S. Plaza upgrades, which we want to start now. We don't want to wait until 2015, 2016, 2017, all the way up to 2020. We want to start it now. And the redecking of the bridge. But interestingly enough, the redecking has not been voted on or approved by the PBA. So this legislation, ladies and gentlemen, simply says this. If the current board is able to come together around a common purpose, they can issue new debt anytime that they feel fit before July of 2014. They would be able to remain an authority, and this legislation will have no practical impact on the PBA. If, however, the PBA is not able to resolve this deadlock and their difference, the issue of new debt prior to July of 2014, they will have to make their final debt payment on that date, and by operation of law, they shall dissolve as an authority. So the dissolution is not up to this piece of legislation. The dissolution is up to the board and to see if they can come and have this issue resolved. I urge all my colleagues to vote yes for this piece of legislation. I know that it's been 20 years. How do I know? Because the Peace Bridge Authority bought one of the houses that was just knocked down 4 months ago, 20 years ago, and left it in blight for 20 years along with 8 others, and an Episcopal church home. And how do I know that? I was the attorney that closed the deal 20 years ago on that property.
So you and this issue go way back.
Yeah.
If the U.S. side is ready to start the expansion, what is the pilot program and why would that hold it up?
You know, I don't understand why things can't be done at the same time. Basically, the pre-inspection program will not start for 6 months until Blaine, Washington gets theirs started, and then ours takes about 12 to 18 months. In the meantime, we have environmental reviews that are already done. There's no reason why we shouldn't start expanding the plaza on the U.S. side. Basically, the Canadian Five and the board, they have an idea of what they want the plaza to look like, but that's not our idea. Our, you know, we should be able to do how in Western New York and New York State how we want the plaza to look.
Right.
It's more expensive, but we didn't balk when the five American members of the Public Bridge Authority voted with the Canadians to get their plaza done at a cost of $120 million. So, mm-hmm. basically, it's that simple. We want to build our plaza a certain way. They want it a different way.
Yeah, you mentioned environmental review, and you are the environmental conservation chairman. Mm-hmm. You know, you are taking into consideration the health of the people who live in that neighborhood.
Oh, absolutely. And the problem for 20 years is that with the trucks idling and sitting on that bridge, and they sit there where there's only two lanes of truck inspection on the U.S. Plaza side, you know, it's been 20 years of smog and pollution that has been in that neighborhood. By expanding this plaza and doing things that we want to do, we want to have buffer zones that and protect those neighborhoods, but move all the traffic towards the west with new ramps going north. There's already a ramp going south, but basically move everything away from the residential area and get these trucks moving on and off the bridge a lot faster.
Okay, so this would give the PBA a year to get their house in order,
right.
And prove that they can actually operate as an authority.
Right, and if they can't, then you know, then they'll have to pay off their debts come July 2014, and when they're debt-free, they're supposed to be out of existence.
All right, we'll see where this goes.
Yeah.
Grisanti.NYsenate.gov.
That's right.
Revitalizing historic properties. That is another issue that you have championed for years, and it appears you aren't about to let it go, even though some of your colleagues think that it may be more of a budget issue. Let's take a look.
Yeah. I listened to the comments of Senator Krueger, and I understand where her comments are coming from, is, you know, that this is not something that could take away from the revenue of the state, and it should be put in the budget. Problem is, if it's not in the budget, you can't just give up. You got to keep trying. Last year, we passed the historic tax credits. It went from 5 to 12 million. Passed both houses. It was vetoed by the governor. But, you know, my fellow colleagues, this is the problem. Yeah, the state could take a fiscal hit, but eventually these properties are going to be back on the tax rolls. And not only going to be on the tax rolls, there are going to be people in these buildings, whether it's a housing development, whether it's a business, are going to be in these buildings, and people are going to move back. I've seen that myself in Buffalo with numerous projects on the historic tax credits, with the Lafayette Hotel, over 350 construction workers, and now there's over 300 people employed there full time. And it couldn't have been done unless you had these historic tax credits. And it's the same thing also utilizing the asbestos credits from before. Now we're going to try it again differently, where the cap is going to be increased from 5 million to 7 million to 9 and then to 12 up until a period of 2019. Now, as I said, I understand what the fiscal hit's going to be, but on the historic tax preservation, you know, to me, when these buildings actually get back on the record and be back on the books and people are working there, it's revenue neutral. So in the beginning, you take a hit, but eventually it balances itself out. I vote aye, Mr. President.
So Senator Krueger, who you mentioned, was the only no vote, so it did pass the Senate.
It did, and I, you know, I understand where she's coming from. She's very fiscal because she worries about, well, you know, if we do this now, we already have the budget that's done, and where's the money going to come from? You know, I believe that the money's there because I believe that some of these projects are already ongoing, and we need to expand this program. And you know, up to going from 5, 7, 9, and 12, you know, I let the governor's office know after it was vetoed going from 5 to 12 that this is something I was going to push for. And you know, it's very important. These work. The historic tax credits work. You know, asbestos remediation credits was another bill that works as well. And people just, they're so concerned about, well, this is going to be a hit. The buildings that are laying there in blight, that's the hit. And then when you rehab them, put them back on the tax rolls, there's a benefit, not only to the municipality where the building's located, but the state as a whole. And then you have people working in the buildings or living in the buildings. And mm-hmm. that's important because you just revitalize an area. And I've seen it myself in Western New York. I've had other senators tell me it works in their areas. So hopefully the governor we get it passed in the Assembly, and then the governor will see that this is something that is revenue neutral and is a benefit for New York State as a whole.
Yeah, one more thing that you know, didn't work in the budget, but something you were pushing for, was more money for the Office for People with Developmental Disabilities,
right.
And now you've just got restored that money too.
Right, exactly. And that was something, the language we put in the budget talked about them, OPWDD, looking in-house to see where they can make some changes. And they got some money from their own in-house, and then there's other money that's going to be restored. So these are our most vulnerable that actually need protections, and we're talking about cutting them. You know, it doesn't make sense to me, so I was glad that we were able to resolve that. You know, and on top of that, I mean, there's, it goes beyond that. There's so many that are living without proper housing, over 2,000 in upstate. I just had a meeting with a phone conference with Commissioner Burke from OPWDD. She recognizes that there's a housing crisis for people in needs that have disabilities, and we're working on trying to resolve that issue. And next year, we're going to try to have in the budget money to OPWDD for housing for people with disabilities that can no longer be cared for by their parents, that need to go into a sustainable housing so their parents know that they're going to be protected when they're gone.
All right. Yeah. So keep holding strong to your convictions.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks so much for being with us, Senator.
Pleasure. Thanks a lot.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator Mark Grisanti. For additional information on the Buffalo School proposal, economic development, and infrastructure issues we discussed, Grisanti.NYsenate.gov.